Okay, so dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the opening ceremony of the Diversity in Asia Fest. We're very glad to have you all here to explore the wonders of Asian cultures and share the theme, Unity and Diversity, with us today. Today we are very pleased to have invited Mr. Khalil Fong, a renowned musician and producer in Hong Kong, and Professor Joseph Sung, Vice Chancellor and President of the Chinese University of Hong Kong, to be our sharing guest today. This is a week-long festival and celebration, a week to celebrate the diversity in Asia and also on this very campus, where the members are from all corners of the world, especially different parts of Asia. The university's mission is to combine tradition with modernity and to bring together China and the West. We are proud of this cosmopolitan and multicultural heritage of this university. Today's session will be conducted in English, as there are a considerable amount of non-Cantonese speakers in the audience, but we'll be happy to take questions from the floor later in Cantonese, Mandarin, or English. The sharing session will start at around 1:30 p.m. with the arrival of Khalil. We'll now first give you a glimpse of what will be going on throughout the week. First of all, please join me in welcoming Professor Dennis Ng, Associate Vice Chancellor and University Dean of Students, to deliver the opening speech. Professor Ng.
Good afternoon, students and colleagues. So I am pleased to welcome you to this kickoff event of the Diversity in Asia Fest, organized by the Globalizing Task Force for Enhancing International Bonding on Campus, or simply IBOND. So the IBOND is set up in response to the Vice Chancellor initiative in further enhancing internationalization and engagement of mainland China at the Chinese University. The group is convened by Professor Simon Shen and supported by totals of 12 student body. So these student associations represent distinct culture and geographical groups, so and have a mission in promoting internationalization related activity on campus. The Chinese university is characterized by the diversity of its student community. So we have over 28,000 undergraduate and postgraduate students, of whom 6,000 come from country and region outside Hong Kong. In addition, we have more than 1,000 exchange students from some 200 universities all around the world. For us, internationalization is not simply about admitting more foreign students or gaming with number to improve the university position in the international university niche tables. Instead, internationalization is a collective effort to know more about other cultures and to look at things with international perspective, understanding that we are all citizens of the global village. One basic requirement is that we understand more about the outside world while keeping our identity and uniqueness, sharing our culture with others, and respecting each other's ways of life. The theme of Diversity in Asia Fest is Unity in Diversity, 多元共融. So this is exactly what we value and strive to achieve. The Diversity in Asia Fest is the first major activity organized by IBOND. So it is a one-week-long festival which aims at further raising the awareness of CHK students on international issues. So the fest consists of a series of seminars, talks, film section, and workshops. The topics covered in the festival range from geopolitics to regional culture, religions to regional history. Speakers include renowned commentators, journalists, religious leaders, and scholars. We do hope that members of the university community will enjoy the wide range of activity being offered to you. So in the opening ceremony today, you will learn more from the dialogue between a Christian and Baha'i believer about their faith and well wills. The former is Professor Joseph Sung, a vice chancellor, while the latter is Ms. Hali Fong, a renowned musician. I am sure their exploration of the meaning of life will inspire our thoughts and ideas about life. So it allows us to reflect more on our way of doing things. So once again, I would like to thank all colleagues and students for supporting this event. I wish all of you an enjoyable afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor. May I now invite Professor Simon Shun, convener of the IBON Task Force, to give a brief introduction of the background of the festival. Professor Shun, please.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Simon Shun. I'm an associate professor teaching international relations here. It would be great if our lecturers at normal times would have the turnout rates of today, and that's our dream. So thanks so much for coming. We're fortunate enough to live, to study, and to work in Hong Kong, a city which is among the most vibrant and most versatile in Asia. Asia is home to 4.1 billion people in our Earth Village, or 60% of the total population. It is natural for different places to have different cultures. However, few cities in Asia are as global as Hong Kong, where you can find virtually all nationalities, all the cuisines and all the religions. Our variety of people, cultures, and ways of living exist here. Our textbook and official publications always describe Hong Kong as a blend of Chinese and Western culture. The very diversity that you are sitting right here stresses that it is an institute linking tradition and modernity, the Orient and the West. It is an institution with undergraduates from around the world, representing all major Asian and non-Asian cultures and traditions. Believing that the CUHK and Hong Kong are focal points of the mixture of different cultures, we have designed this Diversity in Asia Festival, DIA. The DIA aims at raising the awareness of CUHK students on international issues, with the concerted support from a number of student bodies. Through a series of seminars, talks, film sections, and workshops, we very much hope to facilitate local and non-local students' involvement and participation. We shall cover a range of topics from geopolitics to regional culture, relations to area history, etc., etc. in the series. And the seminars include, the speakers will include commentators, journalists, as Professor has expressed. Of course, this is our earnest hope that all of you will take part in these seminars and all the functions in the festivals. Not only because you are a fan of Mr. Fong or fond of Gangnam Style or other seminar speakers, but also because you are curious of knowing everything around you. I believe you must excel in your own field or your major subjects, but the world is more than that. With globalization, we simply cannot stay aloof and be ignorant of the world around us. Each and every one of you has different personalities and preferences, and this is the same to all people across the world. As US President Kennedy said, if we cannot stand now our differences, unless we can make the world safe for diversity. I hope your venture of seeking diversity will not end with this week. Go and find a classmate around you and who did not have the skin colors as you or who did not speak the same language as yours. You will find that the world is larger than you can expect and international relations are not too far away from home. It is right here happening around you at CUHK. Thank you very much for coming again. Please join me to get back to our MC, Mr. Tim Choi, who is the exact leader of the whole program. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Shun. We're pleased to have Ms. Claire Wu from Taiwan, chair of the Student Task Force on Globalizing and Campus Diversity, to give us a short speech. Claire, please.
Thank you, Tim. Dearest VC, teachers, honorable guests, and my fellow students, it is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that I welcome you to the opening ceremony of Diversity in Asia Fest. My name is Claire Wu. I am the chairperson of University Glocalization Student Task Force and the president of Taiwanese Student Association. UGST is a new organization composed of societies coming from all backgrounds, ethnicities, and all around the globe. We aim to promote international awareness and university cohesiveness in our beloved CUHK community. CUHK is more than just a university. To many of us, it's a home where family members share, love, support for each other. Here, 锻炼了普通话 sharpened my English, and learned the Canton English 啦。I'm sure many of you share that same thrilling experience as the sparks of other culture throws to you. And CUHK is capable of teaching us so much because of rich cultural diversity. This diversity in Asia Fest is more than just a time to explore the Asian cultures around us, but a true opportunity to genuinely appreciate them. I have a dream. Like Martin Luther King,I also had a few as my own. It started as small as being able to say, "Dong nai cha, mgai." But then it grew. It grew into a vision of sharing 珍珠奶茶, the Taiwanese pearl milk tea, with my fellow classmates while they hand me that 懂奶茶, the Canton milk tea. And that vision came true just last month with the help of OSA and enthusiastic hearts,like you and me. I would have never imagined myself standing here in front of you, sharing my passion for the cultures on CUHK, but here I am, this dream came true too. Now, my question to you is, what is your dream? What is the change you would like to see in CUHK? Great or small, I encourage you to be that change you want to see in the university, because that's what UGST,and this diversity in Asia Fest is all about. The culture harmony shared by us all. When the beating of the drum echoes the beating of your heart, won't you be that change when tomorrow comes? Yesterday, I had a dream. And today, I share with you this future dream, that one day our community will rise up and live up to its true meanings, to hold the truth to be self-evident,that all members from different cultures are loved and cherished equally. Cultural diversity is such an easier term to say than to actually perform. And sometimes one simply does not know where to begin. UGST is proud to serve as the bridge of our campus between students and university to make that change happen. Here we would like to thank all our member societies in alphabetical order, Isaac, Akus, Kapsa,CSSA, FMSHK, GPA, ISA, MUA, MUN, almost there, TSA, and U-Rounders for all their dedications towards this event. I cannot express enough of my excitement towards this upcoming week because of all the kind-hearted people devoting themselves into it. There will be a series of interesting seminars hosted by the most fascinating scholars.And this Friday's International Ball Night will be your perfect chance to practice cultural cohesiveness on making new friends. Last but not least, today is not just the opening of an event week. It is also the start of enhancing our community's international awareness. And that, my fellow friends, shall be an ever-ending journey. On behalf of UGSD, I thank you all for coming today. And now I would like to invite you to enjoy. Let us pull up.The Feast for the Mind, as I proudly present you Diversity in Asia Fest poetry. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Claire. I think we'll have the poetry a bit later, but we will have that eventually. So let me first give you an introduction of the whole week ahead of us. Okay, so today, this is the main thing. This is the most flagship talk.Of the week. And then we have a couple of booths outside representing cultures and nationalities all over Asia. We have 8 booths outside. Please feel very free to join us out there. We have food and we have performances. And especially we have arranged a very updated and very up-to-time thing outside. It is an exhibition on propaganda poster of North Korea. So we are very fortunate to have invited a versatile collector of North Korean posters outside. So it's mostly related to war, so very up to date. And so for today, we have other events besides this sharing between Khalil and also our Vice Chancellor. We have our Mu Shou Pu, the artistic expression and religious sentiment in ancient Egypt. So the splendid ancient Egyptian artwork comprises rich religious elements and philosophical expressions.Despite its geographical location in Africa, Egypt is, in fact, belongs to the Near East in terms of its cultural development. Professor Pu is a professor of CHK History Department. He's also one of the best and most renowned Egyptologists in Asia. So please feel free to join us after this event at 4. It's at Chang Yu Tong Building. It is a white building next to the University train station. And tonight we would have, I'm sorry, it's only in Chinese, but I could interpret that. So it is Steve Jung. It is about K-pop, and then he would talk about the social institution and the political institution in South Korea from Gangnam Style. So it is tonight, right here at CUHK, from 7 to 8:30, and it will be held at Sino Building LT2 at Chungcheong College. And this event is co-organized with Roundtable Education. Please feel very free to join us tonight. And then tomorrow, it will be Chip Chow, the Middle East and the Sunset of an Empire. Mr. Chow is a best-selling author, a columnist, and a former producer for the BBC. And so we're very lucky to have invited Mr. Chow here to speak about the British involvement in the Middle East from the era of Lawrence of Arabia to the two Middle Eastern wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. So it is here in YIA tomorrow, LT2, so just right beside the LT1. And then it is a very attractive event by Professor Gordon Matthews. It is about the globalization in Chongqing Mansion. And Professor Matthews has promised us he would bring us some African guests from Chongqing Mansions. They are asylum seekers in Hong Kong, so I'm sure that they would have the most fascinating stories to share with you. So please come with us, join us in LT4 YIA on Wednesday from 7 to 8:30. And then on Wednesday night, we would have a site event called One Asia 4 Bytes equals infinity. So we've invited four youngsters from Hong Kong. They basically cycled from Hong Kong to Paris. So how could they do that? Ask them. I'm not pretty sure, but I'm sure that it is very, very fascinating and interesting. Please join us in New Asia College, Chi Sing Ho. And the time is 8:30 p.m. to 10. And then it'll be the last flagship event on Thursday. It is Diversity Comes from Mutual Respect by Ms. Fami Wong. He's a director of Unison in Hong Kong, which is a wonderful organization serving the needs and the rights for ethnic minorities in Hong Kong. So the time will be 7 to 8:30 at Chang Yu Tong Building, LT7. So same, the white building next to the train station. And then the very awaited International Ball Night, as just mentioned by Claire. Not sure where Claire is now, but it is on Friday from 6:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. It is very, very cheap, the ticket, only 20 Hong Kong dollars. So please come, and we will sell ticket from the Student Task Force booth right outside LT1, so you can find us and then buy the ticket. So what would it include? Buffet, good food, good drinks, so, you know, performances, only at a price of 20 Hong Kong dollars. So please join us. Last but not least, finally, we have the fest within the fest. So we would have three movie nights from Monday to Wednesday. We'll be showing and screening three movies from around Asia from 9 to 11 p.m. So Monday and Tuesday will be at NA, New Asia College, Chi Sing Ho, and Wednesday will be at Morningside College Theatre. So Monday we'll be showing an Iranian movie, A Separation. Tuesday, My Name is Khan, and Wednesday, a Thai movie, Uncle Bumi, Who Can Recall His Past Lives. So this is the introduction of the entire week. Please do join us. And now, so today, I'm sure that you are coming for, you know, obviously not for me, but for Professor Joseph Song and also Mr. Khalil Fong. So I'm not going to speak a lot. But before Khalil joined us, we must have some basic knowledge about the Baha'i faith. I'm quite sure that most of you sitting here, if you are not a Baha'i, you might not be very knowledgeable about this religion. So we are very, very honored and pleased to have invited a sociology professor from the University of Hong Kong, Professor David Palmer, to join us today. And Professor Palmer has actually spent time in ZUHK for 4 years, if I'm not wrong. And David is also a member of the Baha'i community in Hong Kong. So please join me in welcoming David to give out a very, not very short, but a very detailed introduction of the Baha'i faith. David, please.
Students and friends of Chinese University of Hong Kong, it's a great honor for us from the Baha'i community of Hong Kong to have this opportunity to be invited to engage with the community of the Chinese University of Hong Kong to explore how we can overcome our differences, how we can build unity in diversity. Around 100 years ago, Abdul Baha, the son of Baha'u'llah, wrote a tablet in which he said, "China, China, go to China. China is the country of the future. 中国, 中国到中国去, 中国是未来的国家." And here we are today. In those days, 100 years ago, it was difficult for people to understand what Abdul Baha meant when he said that China is the country of the future. But today it becomes more clear. And undoubtedly, as the next century unfolds, the place of China in the building of an emerging global civilization will be a very, very important one. And here we are in Hong Kong, a place which, like no other place in the world, these two great civilizations of China and of the West have fully merged and integrated. And here we are in the Chinese University of Hong Kong, where we have the equal upholding and promotion of these two civilizations within a unique local culture of Hong Kong and its regional Cantonese distinctive traditions. We're going to be speaking and we're going to be meeting in a few minutes with Khalil Fang, Fang Datong. So let's reflect a little on the term of Datong, of the great unity, in the Li Ji. So Datong has been the dream of the Chinese people for over 2,500 years, ever since the great unity chapter of the Book of Rights, where it is said, "Da Dao Zhi Xing Ye, Tian Xia Wei Gong," when the great will prevails, a public spirit will rule all under heaven. Shi Wei Da Tong. This is the great unity. Now, in the 1930s, one of the earliest Chinese Baha'is, Professor Cao Yunxiang, the first president of Tsinghua University, was the first translator of the Baha'i scriptures into the Chinese language. And he translated the name Baha'i, the name of the religion, into Da Tong Jiao, because he saw that the core teaching of the Baha'i faith, the greatest peace, is the same as the dream of the Chinese people of Shi Jie Da Tong, of the great unity. Baha'u'llah, who lived in the 19th century, proclaimed that we are now entering a new era in the history of human civilization and in the history of religion, and that this is a time when we must overcome and transcend all of our differences. This is the time where the dreams of the poets and prophets of old will now come to realization. If we consider, for example, the prophet Isaiah, who said in the Old Testament, "The wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead him." All the different people of different races and nationalities, of different religions and social classes, who over the centuries and millennia have fought against each other and oppressed each other. But now as we enter this new era of world unity, of globalization, these different groups, these ethnicities, these classes, these nations, will learn to overcome their differences and to live together in peace. They will beat their swords into plowshares, said Isaiah, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take sword against nation, nor will they trade for war anymore. So Baha'u'llah stressed, all the peoples and nations are of one family, the children of one father, and should be to one another as brothers and sisters. You are the fruits of one tree, he said, and the leaves of one branch. The fundamental purpose animating the faith of God and his religion is to safeguard the interests and promote the unity of the human race, and to foster the spirit of love and fellowship among men. His son Abdu'l-Bahá said that if religion were to be a source of conflict and division, it would be better not to have religion. The purpose of religion is to safeguard the interests and promote the unity of the human race. These principles and laws, said Baha'u'llah, these firmly established and mighty systems, all the religious systems, the major religious systems of the world, have proceeded from one source and are the rays of one light. That they differ from one another is to be attributed to the varying requirements of the ages in which they were promulgated. They have the same source and the same purpose. They should not be the source of conflict and division. For proclaiming this message of peace, Baha'u'llah lived in Iran in the mid-19th century. And in that country, for proclaiming this message of peace, for overcoming the prejudices between Jews, Christians, Muslims, and Zoroastrians in the Middle East, Baha'u'llah was imprisoned, tortured, and exiled for 40 years. Thousands of his followers were persecuted and massacred. Baha'u'llah was exiled from his birthplace of Tehran, thrown into a dungeon, then exiled to Baghdad, to Istanbul, so to Iraq, Turkey, Egypt, and finally to the Palestinian city of Aqqa, which is now in the state of Israel. But his message, the message of Baha'u'llah, could not be stamped out. Today, it has spread to 218 nations and territories around the world, to over 100,000 localities and over 2,000 tribes and ethnic groups, forming one of the most diverse and globalized community on this planet. These Baha'is and their friends and collaborators around the world, whether they live in small villages or large metropolises, whether they are in tribes or in cities, they're all engaged in a process of personal and social transformation. The betterment of the world, Baha'u'llah said, can be accomplished through pure and goodly deeds, through commendable and seemly conduct. Baha'u'llah said that we have been created noble with spiritual qualities inside our souls. And so as individuals, at a personal level, our life should be dedicated to improving ourselves, to transforming ourselves, to reflecting these noble and divine qualities which we each and all have inside of us. At the social level, however, we should also be working toward building a better world for the abolition of religious prejudice, the abolition of racial and ethnic prejudice, the harmony between science and religion, the full equality between women and men, the reduction of extremes of wealth and poverty, and building global citizenship through grassroots participation within a system of global governance. Because our individual life cannot be separated from our social life. So if we want to improve, we need to improve both ourselves and our own behavior, and we need to build a better society. We cannot do one without the other. We must do the two at the same time. And so we must be peacemakers, as Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." So how can we be peacemakers? And of course, there are many different ways of doing so. Each of us, in our lives, in our studies, in our work, in our community, we can each do a little thing, or many things, to build peace around us. And what I'd like to present now and is to invite you to join us in walking along a path of service to humanity, which Baha'is have been working on in the past decades. And so what does this involve? We're talking about a path which is open to those of all faiths or of no faith, those who share a common desire to learn from each other, to learn how to put their ideals into action for the betterment of this world. And what we do is we start with study circles, where together, in a collaborative and self-directed fashion, we develop knowledge, skills, and spiritual insight to see how we can transform ourselves and transform the world around us. And we think about the younger generation. How can we uplift them? How can we nurture their virtues? How can we empower the ideals of the youth? And so we nurture the hearts and minds of the next generation, develop their spirit of service and their leadership skills. And building on these small actions of improving our own lives, of building friendship and unity in our family, with our neighbors, with our co-workers, with our friends and co-students. How do we go out into the community to build a better community and even to go even further out to engage in social action? So that all together, regardless of what our background is, where we come from, which part of the world we live in, we're all together engaged in a process of building a better world. Now, all of you have received a little survey. And on this little survey, if you're interested in learning more about this path of service to humanity, I'd like to encourage you to answer the questions on the survey to see which way are you most interested in serving humanity. Or if you have a question, you can write it on the back of that sheet. And at the end of this session, there will be volunteers at the doors here who will be collecting those surveys. And so there will be some sessions where we can explore further with you how we can engage in the process, in this path of service, so that we can build a better world, because, as Baha'u'llah said, the earth is but one country, and mankind its citizens. 地球乃一国，万人皆其民. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David.
Hi, I'm Khalil. I'm a musician, songwriter, and producer in Hong Kong, and I'm very lucky to do what I do, and I enjoy it very much.
Hi, everyone. My name is Joseph Song. I'm the Vice Chancellor and the President of the Chinese University of Hong Kong.
And the Baha'i Faith teaches that all the religions come from one source, and that all of these religions are here to bring about the unity of mankind. It states that music and arts are a ladder for the soul. In music and arts, I would have a responsibility to create music, to create art that influences the world in a positive fashion.
I know about Christianity when I was a high school student. But at that time, I think my knowledge is really in the head instead of having real faith in God. But as I'm getting older and go through many turns in my life, including some difficult time, I start to realize that what it says in the Bible is actually very true. I would say that now I'm much more a true Christian than I was 20 years ago.
In the Baha'i Faith, it says that the world is one country and mankind its citizens. It says that everyone, every mind is a gem rich in immeasurable treasures. And I think these treasures are virtues. As long as, you know, society is able to promulgate this idea that in everyone there's a great potential to do good, I think that is a start.
I agree that we live in a world where there is a lot of conflicts, a lot of mistrust between different population, different ethnic groups from different countries. Being an educated person, being a university student, we should learn to accommodate each other, although we may hold different views and beliefs. Doesn't mean that everybody has to follow my will and my way of living. So I think a university education should provide such an environment for us to learn to live with each other and love each other and work as a team.
If you would like to know more about me, my religion, and why all humanity is one family, join me with Professor Sung in CUHK Diversity in Asia Fest in April.
Stay tuned. Unity in diversity, 多元共融.
Unity in diversity, 多元共融.
Okay, it is a long-awaited moment. So let me first give you a clue of our next guest. Okay, so our guest needs no introduction. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Khalil Fong. Ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, may I have some attention, please? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You know, Khalil is absolutely attractive, I know. But so the Vice Chancellor is actually having a very urgent meeting in Central now, but he'll be back very, very, very soon. And then he will join us, I think, at around 2. So first of all, we will now have a ceremonial recitation of a quotation from different scriptures, including the Baha'i Faith scriptures and also the Bible by students in different major Asian languages. Student, please, yeah. And please give them a very big hand. They are from different countries in Asia.
The world is a one country and mankind is citizens. The diversity of the family should be a cause of love and harmony.
家庭内的多元环境是爱和和谐的出发点.
As it is in music, where many different notes blend together in the making of a perfect chord. Ia adalah music yang mengandung campuran nota yang berbeza bersama-sama dalam pembuatan chord yang sempurna.
New commandment I give to you, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. मैं तुम्हें एक आज्ञा देता हूँ कि तुम एक दूसरे से करो प्यार, जिस तरह मैं तुम्हें करता हूँ प्यार. वह उसी तरह आप सभी एक दूसरे से करो प्यार.
If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. 如果有人说我爱神，却恨他的兄弟，他就是个骗子。
For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. Kia puti mirak chai kong, kia pusang me samara ni prakia tikia koihen.
Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God.
사랑하는 자들아, 우리가 서로를 사랑하게 하라. 사랑은 하나님께 속한 것이니 사랑하는 자들은 모두 하나님께로부터 나며 하나님을 알지어다.
Love one another with brotherly affection. Sayang satu sama lain bagaikan saudara.
This is not in similarity, but unity in diversity, in the comparison and conciliation of differences. 平和は類似性を統合したものではなく、多様性を統合したものです。つまり相違点の比較と融和から生まれます。
We have not become a melting pot, but a beautiful mosaic. Different people, different beliefs, different yearnings, different hopes, different dreams. 我哋嘅世界並冇變成一個大圓缸，反而更似一幅美麗、好斑斕瑰麗嘅馬賽克畫。唔同嘅人，唔同嘅信念，唔同嘅追求，唔同嘅期盼，唔同嘅夢。
Thank you very much. Yes. So it is now the sharing session. So please give a big round of applause to our students from all corners of Asia. They've spent some time preparing. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we may have different accents, different languages, but we have one same hope and dream, which is unity and diversity. So today, this is the reason, the very reason why we have invited Mr. Khalil Fong here to our sharing. Khalil is a renowned musician and producer in Hong Kong, and he's also a member of the Baha'i community in Hong Kong. So please, once again, join me in welcoming Mr. Khalil Fong to the podium. Ladies and gentlemen. And then today's moderator would be Professor Simon Shun, who's an international relations scholar in COHK, and he'll be moderating the talk today. Professor Shun, please.
Wow, so I think we are done with the formalities, and Professor Shun would be coming in 5 minutes, I think. Maybe he's practicing some songs. So I just want to know, how many of you are fans of Mr. Fong? Can you please give me some hands? Wow. And, all right, how many of you are fans of Professor Song? Well, even more, wow. Maybe you two should join some bands later on. I think today's section, we need a little moderation. I was given some script to read, but I don't think it's a wise thing to do because obviously no attention here. So I think maybe we start from the very basic because we've just learned about your religion. But your name is so different. I mean, Fong Dai Tong, right? And is it named precisely because of the religion?
Actually, you could say that my name is derived from the meaning that is often found in the Baha'i faith, which is unity. And my grandfather, who, basically, he wasn't a Baha'i, but he, you know, he was aware of my parents' beliefs. And so when they were looking for a name, he said, so that's really how it was. It's just very simple. And I'm very happy because I really do, although some people, when they hear the name, say, is that a real name? You know, but I'm very happy to have that name. And yeah.
So you were born as a believer of the Baha'i faith?
Well, actually, in the Baha'i faith, we are encouraged to, well, we call it the independent investigation of truth. So everyone should go and study as much as you like of philosophy, religion, anything, to see what you feel you would like to believe in. So at the age of 15, each individual is allowed to choose. That's the age that you're allowed to choose. So when I was 15, I, you know, gave it some thought. And I decided that I would become a Baha'i. So that's the most straightforward way for me, yeah.
Yeah, as you might know, our VC, Professor Song, is a Christian. So I think before his arrival, maybe you can tell us why you chose to believe in the Baha'i faith instead of Christianity. Yeah, because it seems to be a competition among the layman perspective. So maybe you can let us know your choices, yeah.
Well, I wouldn't say that I would chose to become a Baha'i instead of becoming a Christian. Because in the Baha'i faith, we also accept Christ as the Son of God, as just as Christians believe. Yes, theologically, I'm sure there will be differences, but which I don't think today is the day which we will speak of these. And I think each individual may go have their own study and research. But I guess for me, the Baha'i faith, the three major things brought up in the faith are the oneness of God, oneness of religion, and oneness of mankind. So to me, these gave me a very good perspective, I think, for how I felt about.
Ladies and gentlemen, so our Vice Chancellor has eventually arrived. And please give another big round of applause to both Khalil and Joseph.
So yeah, for me, it gave a very good perspective for me on how I saw the world and how I felt that I would want to interact with the world. I think that for a Baha'i, we see that, well, or at least we believe that all religions come to mankind at different times to bring about the same spiritual principles at each time. Yet, the social teachings will change because humankind changes. Humankind evolves. We have new science. We have new understanding. So in that sense, we need new values in order to help us to, let's say, function properly in this world. So for me, that's a very basic explanation of why I became a Baha'i.
Yeah, and thanks for coming, Professor Song. And we've just gave all the attendants some introduction about the Baha'i faith. So today we have some dialogues. So first of all, maybe you can tell us how well do you know about the faith, Baha'i faith?
Well, first of all, I'm surprised to see so many people here because because when I teach, there are only about 20, 30 students. So the other 1,900 must be because of you.
Actually, most of them said that they are your fans as well, right?
No.
Are you?
To answer your question, I really don't know very much about Baha'i. Only after I was asked to participate in this dialogue, I looked up Wikipedia, what is... No, honestly, I looked up from Wikipedia and I know just a little bit about it. And yesterday we had lunch together and I learned from both Khalil and your mother more about this faith. But I'm a Christian ever since I was a high school student. I study in a high school that you also study in, and
I'm not Christian though. Yeah.
So you know that our school has no religious background. Everything is very free, and people can join whatever activities they want to. But I must say, for me, faith is a long journey. It's not like you know something or you learn some information, you passed an examination and you got it. You get a credential of being a Christian or a Buddhist. No, I think to me it's a long journey and I'm still in the middle of this journey from everything which is supertentorial, which means in the brain, it's knowledge, it's information, to something that's deep in my heart. It takes a lot of life experience to assimilate that. And for me, one of the most important life experience, I have many difficult times in my life, one of which was in 1989 when I decided to do a PhD in Canada and took my wife with me to Canada in January after we got married. Big mistake, all right? No, it's the mistake is not that I got married. The mistake is you should not get married and go to a new country and take a new job in a very cold winter, okay? So, and then end up, my wife said, I couldn't live here anymore. So 3 months later, she left, and I was left alone in the dark and in the cold for 3 years. But that was only one example of my difficult life. And the other very impressive, something that left a scar in my heart was during the time of SARS. As you know, a lot of life and death, lots of sweat and tears, a lot of struggling. But upon which I actually reflect a lot on my life and on my faith. So I would say that my journey has made a sharp turn at that point, and I become more, I can understand what the Bible's teaching much more than I thought I would. And for example, when the Bible said we are just like dews in the morning and breeze in the summer, you just pass by very quickly. I mean, this sort of thinking actually never impressed me when I was a young and healthy person until I saw myself and all my colleagues also facing imminent death. Then I started to realize how true this could be. So that is my, well, I shouldn't speak too much, but I think because the other 1,900 is for you, so you better speak more. But that is part of my journey.
Well, so today we hope to have some dialogue among the religions, but is it really possible to have direct communication between the religions? Because sometimes, as we are reading from the news, the Christians, the Muslims, and all of us, they are fighting among one another. So how is it possible for your faith to reconcile the differences among them?
I think the ones who are fighting are actually very, very small. If compared to the entire world, a very small percentage. And I think that in truth, the essence of every religion is that we are able to live in peace with one another. And I think that, I don't feel that any of the spiritual teachers would actually disagree with each other, in a sense, in the goal of love and unity. So I think that it's really about understanding each other, having conversations, I think it's really about brotherhood, friendship, and to understand that we are here for the human race and for nothing else. Right?
Yep. And one of the reasons for us to have this festival is that our VC found that there are some disharmony in the society and on campus. So from your perspective, how can that be reconciled from your religious background and your faith? And
Well, I think nobody in Hong Kong will deny that we have a lot of disharmony in our society. Not so much in the campus, I'm pleased to acknowledge that, but really there is a lot of disharmony, whether it is political, cultural, or financial disharmony. I don't have any solution to the problem, what we're having. I just feel that we need to sometimes understand each other better before we criticize, before we object. Let me give you an example. Some years ago, I went to Israel, and somebody took me to a beautiful place called Dead Sea for a swim. For girls here, you should go to that sea, because the soil is supposed to be very good for the skin. But one of the attractions is that the salinity of the water is really so high that you can sit on the water, or basically almost like walking on the water. And then once I dipped myself into the water, I was surrounded by a group of teenagers, I think about 10, 15 years old. They all come around me, and I don't know what they're talking about, because they are not speaking English. I don't understand Hebrew, but they speak a very funny language that I have no idea. But somehow they just come around me and they put this soil on my face and on my body. Yeah. And I was surprised. I don't know what attracts me to them. I must look like a panda or something. But after playing with them for some time, I start to realize that their mother, who are calling them from the shore, are actually Muslims. They're all covered with this, I don't know what this clothes called, black stuff, the black cloth. There's a name for it. Anyway, they are, their mother were waving at them, and they dress in Muslim, and then I suddenly realized, oh, these are Palestinian children. These are not Jews. And then I said to myself, isn't Palestinian students should be throwing bottles and stones at people? I mean, this is what I saw on CNN, but today I see these most friendly kids around me, playing with me, and they are Palestinians. So, I mean, sometimes we see things through the eyes of a television or through the eyes of other people, media and so on, but we may not know the whole truth. I mean, we may not know that their real faces. So, back to my faith, I think what Jesus said is, I did some homework last night. Jesus said, do not judge the others, or you will be judged. For as you have been judging, so you will be judged, and with your measures will it be measured to you. And why do you take the note of the grain of dust in your brother's eye, but take no note of the bit of wood which is in your eye? Or how would you say to your brother, let me take out the grain of dust from your eye, when you yourself have a bit of wood in your eyes? So I think we sometimes we really don't see that we have problems ourselves, but we are more prone to, we are more ready to criticize the others, right? They are dirty, they are rude, but we could be very rude too. I mean, so I think, I hope that our student will learn to be able to look, but put yourself into the shoes of the others, see things from, learn more about them at least, and see things from their perspective, and try to understand why they do this and why they don't do that. Then maybe we are more accommodating than what we are.
In fact, yes, it actually just reminded me of, you know, often, because I was born in Hawaii, and that's a really multicultural environment, and, you know, there are people from all backgrounds, and it's a very friendly place, generally, and, there are always some people who are gonna, you know, do something bad now and then, but, you know, after going to Hawaii, I moved to Shanghai, because my parents wanted me to, you know, learn the Chinese culture and to learn Mandarin. And I think that was a very interesting experience, because I really went to local school, and from Hawaii, where, you know, everyone is like, hey, shakara, hey, which is like, hey, bro, you know, what's up? In Shanghai, it's like, you know, you sit in class. When you want to answer, you know, when you want to answer a question or say anything. So it was night and day. And I actually slept.
What is this?
就是你要回答 老师或者是要举手 for anything in class.
举手这样。
But I slept through the first 3 months because I didn't understand the language. But you know, the teachers were really wonderful. The teachers were very wonderful, and they would take me aside during recess, their break time, and they would teach me, you know, very slowly, you know, the Chinese characters, and I made a lot of friends there, and you know, till this day, I still keep in touch with my teachers there. And so, then Hong Kong, and you know, I've been in Hong Kong for about 11 years, and so I often would hear different friends from different places. They might say, you know, ah. 对啊,台湾人啊,哦,对啊,香港人啊, you know, 对啊, whatever. And I would say, yes, true, but, you know, they have, every culture I have found has great strengths, and each has their weakness. And I think that I've learned that when we learn from each other in that sense, then we begin to merge our skills and to find the best in each other, just as Professor Song has said.
Thanks, to have you. Do I have to do this too? Yeah. All right. So you are a very prominent singer right now. So I think your fans would be interested to know about your career's path, whether you have brought your religious faith into your music, because I'm also your fans and I listen to some of your songs, but I want to know which songs of yours would be able to find some of the Baha'i elements, and then I can pay more attention next time.
Well, I would say I try not to preach in my music, because I like to generally let the music reflect how I wish to lead my life or certain perspectives. So I would say that, you know, you could find certain hints or certain values in my music. But I would say, for me, a very important song, I wouldn't even say it's a very specifically Baha'i meaning, but it was a song that I wrote because I saw a lot of suicides happening. And I wanted to write a song that would give hope and give a bit of let someone have a bit of thought before they decided this. And, you know, for me, sometimes I would think, well, are they really going to hear it? Or, you know, is it really going to help? Sometimes I would even doubt that. But I wrote the song, and a couple of years later, three or four years later, I received, I forgot if it was a letter or a message through somewhere. And it was someone who was, I think, was a fan or a recent fan, and they had said, I had actually had a very difficult time, and I was contemplating to commit suicide. And it seemed quite serious. But she said she remembered this song, and at that moment, it deterred her from that. So for me, that was very meaningful, and that was more valuable than any kind of award or anything that I could get. So I think that is really about using the arts to affect someone in the, you know, smallest way possible, or even the greatest way.
Professor Song, you're also a very famous singer. So do you think, due to the same reasons, to harmonize the campus and society, and or do you have other ambitions when you are singing, etc.?
My singing was a joke. I never volunteered to sing. I was pushed onto the stage, and never mind about my singing. But you're supposed to ask me some other questions.
It's written on my script here, but anyway, I think your specialty is in the medical discipline. So the official question is that how can you bring your Christian faith into your discipline?
Into my discipline? Oh, that's very easy, because as I mentioned before, I think medicine is not purely science. Medicine is half science, half humanities. So you should have the scientific part, which tells you, based on scientific evidence, what is the best treatment for this and what is the best diagnosis for that. And then when you practice on your patient, you have to have your heart. You have to put your personal touch to it. So I think it's a mixture of both. But people may say that, okay, well, science is logic, and scientific-minded people may not really think that there is a God before they can actually see him. You have to see something to believe it. So scientists are less likely to be a religious person. I would tell you this is absolutely not true. Let me tell you what Albert Einstein said. Right? Again, I look up what Albert Einstein said. Albert Einstein, well, I think we all believe, most people believe that he is the greatest scientist of the century. And he said, my religion consists of a humble admiration of the illimitable superior spirit who reveals himself in the slight details that we are able to perceive with our frail and feeble mind. He said, I want to know about God. I want to know the thoughts of God. Everything else is just detail. So such a great scientist, although he even hypothesized how the universe was started with his Big Bang theory, but he never denies that behind this Big Bang, there is an almighty God who started, who lit the fire and started the bang. And to me, more we know about the world, the more we actually think that we are so small, and we are so trivial, and things cannot just happen by chance or randomly. I mean, looking outside is a universe, but if you look at ourselves, we are a universe ourselves. We have a universe inside here. What I'm saying is that, have you seen a movie by Steven Spielberg many years ago called Inner Space? And what he said was that they tried to miniaturize a spaceship and put in a little needle and inject into that patient's artery or vein. And then it goes into the person's circulation. And then, oh, he's driving this spaceship and travel through the lung, the kidney, the heart, the blood cells, and so on. And he was absolutely amazed. We are a universe inside us. And how can you not admire the creator of life, the creator of this universe, if you know just a little bit about it? All right? You may think that you and I are very simple living organisms, but no, there are so many things that we still don't understand and we still don't know. The more you explore, the more you realize how little we actually can understand. So my faith has absolutely no contradiction with my scientific mind. And in fact, during the period of SARS, when we have run out of all the medicine that we know of, when we have tried every means to save life, but still to no avail, the doctors came to my office and we had prayer meeting every morning at 11 o'clock for our colleagues and for our patients. And this is, on looking back, this is the outcry of faith at the time of realizing our limitation and out of despair. So I truly believe that if anything, my career, my knowledge, my expertise can only bring me more closer look to the Almighty God.
Is it the same in the Baha'i faith?
Definitely. The Baha'i faith actually the Baha'i faith basically tells us that science and religion must go hand in hand, and that science without religion can be a dangerous thing, and especially without the ethics and morals. And religion without science can have a tendency to be superstition. So I think that they definitely, just as Professor Sung has said, they go hand in hand. I think that I've also seen a documentary before, very, very interesting for myself, because this documentary spoke of different scientists and their views on the creation and the creator, whether there is a God or not. Some of them believed in God, some of them didn't. Some of them did not have, they were undecisive. But there were a couple who said that they believed that no matter what, because in their findings they say that science and religion started simultaneously from the Stone Age, at the time when they could see writings on the wall. They said to them it began at the same time, so they couldn't study them separately. So I think that's a very interesting concept. And I think, you know, from a more simpler idea of world citizenship, I've always seen myself as a world citizen, not belonging to any specific country. But in science, you know, after finding that we have the universe, as you say, which is limitless or nearly limitless, which I'm not sure, I'm not a scientist, but in that perspective, when we see the world, we're just a speck. And so I think that for us to see, you know, that we live on this speck and that we still have so much conflict and fighting, I think that we still have a lot of potential, because we're just a speck. We can do a lot, and I'm sure we can create a lot of positive and good things. So I think if we keep that in perspective, I think that's also something very helpful.
You know, I think you are kind of special among all the celebrities. Sometimes I go to radio, television, but it seems that you're quite different from them, because you have a very clear identity in terms of the religion. But in this kind of circle, you face backspitting and then slandering and all kinds of problems targeting as these celebrities. So how would you handle these kind of potential troubles?
Well, I would say that I'm lucky that I don't have much. There haven't been many people slandering or backbiting against me. At least I don't think so. But I would say that I see gossip and backbiting everywhere I go, in every, you know, different area of life. So I think this is something that I tend to avoid, and Baha'is are always told to avoid backbiting, because it's something that's very disruptive, destructive, and it prevents people from being able to improve. It makes a greater distance between each other. The more you spread a rumor about someone, the more that person, if that person hears it, they'll be angered, they'll be hurt. And I think change and transcendence, transformation, comes when one feels that we are all here for self-improvement, to improve ourselves, because I have the room to improve. And one more thing, actually, this is a little bit off topic, but as Doctor was saying, to use your heart in your work. And in the Baha'i Faith, this is work is worship, work is like prayer. If you do something to the best of your abilities with a very genuine heart, that is as if you're worshiping. And I think that in our lives, in every aspect of our lives, will improve the quality of our family, of our society, of our relations between the countries. Yeah,
and to be frank, even in the academia, we have a lot of backbiting and slandering. So, Professor, how can you teach us to handle these kind of problems as well, as a Christian?
What problem?
Backbiting, slandering, for example, in the academia, people are talking badly behind you about different things that doesn't exist. So, how would you handle these kind of issues?
First of all, you should try to avoid using Facebook. Then there will be less rumors about yourself. I think just be yourself. It's very important. In fact, to be a celebrity, it's something really tough. You have to sacrifice a lot. You sacrifice your privacy, your private life, your sacrifices, you lost a lot of freedom. You cannot, for example, I cannot go out to to be my yudan. I cannot go and buy some yudan and eat on the street. People will put my picture on Pinduoduo tomorrow, or Simon will put my picture on his Facebook tomorrow. And I'll be in trouble. So you actually sacrifice a lot, but I think one very important thing is, do not see yourself bigger than what it should be. I mean, we are just human beings. We are no better than the others. You may walk a different path compared to the others, but it doesn't mean that you are cleverer, you are more powerful than the other. So I just take it easy and be myself, and be honest to your feelings. I think that's the most important thing, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, to follow up a bit, a few months ago when you were promoting harmony among the mainlanders and the local Hong Kong people, you faced some kind of, online criticisms.
Mm.
So how did you feel at that time, and then how did you manage it?
Well, when I wrote that blog about my Chinese identity, or my heart as a Chinese, I know that it is going to be controversial. And I know that there will be people disagree and even dislike what I'm going to say. Why I did that was because I feel very uncomfortable to see such conflicts between, to me, Hong Kong Chinese and Chinese Chinese in Hong Kong. So I just want to voice my own feeling, my very true feeling, and my stance on this. You cannot expect everybody to agree with you. If you are a leader, especially, you simply cannot expect everybody to like you or agree with you. But you will still have to have your own views on things and your stance, and explain to people why you think like this, why you do this and not doing that. So my position at that time was, this is my honest feeling, and as a teacher, I feel that I should let people know my attitude on this. And if people doesn't like it, they may criticize me, but so be it. Turns out, I think I have received one third of emails or feedbacks criticizing my view, and two third agree. And I can roughly tell from this feedback, the older people seem to agree with me, the younger people disagree. So I don't know why, but I think after a certain age, you will see things from a slightly different perspective. And you go through the time when Hong Kong was a British colony, and you know, you probably know more what it was like when we were a second-class citizen in a British colony. So I'm just reporting what I have gone through when I was a kid.
Yeah, seems that I'm also quite old in this regard. Can you, as an American or born in America, someone, have you ever experienced this kind of identity problem as well? Because you have a very interesting mixture of experience in mainland China, Hong Kong, and the States. So, how would you identify your identity? Is it, yeah?
Well, like I mentioned shortly, I identify myself as a world citizen. So, anywhere I go, if I can make friends there, I feel that's home. So for me, I really feel that I'm a citizen of the entire world, and that it's just a great thing to be able to go there and just to meet new friends and to learn from them, and to exchange with them, and it's just one human family, as we spoke of earlier. So I've never had a trouble identifying with any particular culture, because I just feel that the entire world is one great colorful culture in itself. Yeah.
Can I add something to this? I think whether we like it or not, our world is shrinking, and it's shrinking fast. And everything is no longer a local issue. Everything becomes a global issue. Think about diseases, influenza, for example. All right, what's happening in Shanghai these days is threatening us as much as in India or in other places. Whether the climate change, it's not just about North Pole or South Pole, it's going to drown many countries around the world. Financial crisis, just name a few. So we are becoming a global village, really. Literally, because every impact, it's worldwide. On the other hand, a few weeks ago, there was a famous, our business school has invited a famous person who is the vice president of GE General Electric. It's one of the largest company in the world. You think GE is a American company, but Mr. John Rice, the vice president, said, GE is not an American company because they employ actually non-Americans from India, from China, from other parts of the world, much more than the American who lives in America. So from a big company's perspective, all companies should be global, and you can, the successful company is the one who can attract talents from all corners of the world to work for that company to put together their brains and the best idea to produce a product. So for every product now they are producing, there might be idea coming from India, a little bit from China, and then the engineers from Sweden. And they would never ever have a team of people just in Minnesota, Minneapolis. and just like that. They are very global. So I think, well, the world is changing and we have to follow this change. We have to expand our horizon, our vision, and not just to say, I'm a Hong Kong person and my career must be here. I would not step out of Victoria Harbour. And my future job has to be here. I think we have to learn to be mobile and you make sure that you can adapt to and you can fit into any place, any jobs around the world. I think this is your future. Otherwise, you will be limiting your own future by this tunnel vision.
Yeah. By the way, for more details on globalization, you can come to my class on Global Studies 2101. I'm hinted to open the floor indeed. Before formally opening the floor, some of our colleagues have conducted an interesting online lucky draw, right?
Yes.
I don't know how they managed to do it, so maybe you better introduce yourself.
Okay. So we have conducted an online lucky draw, so we have three lucky people here with us in the audience. So I believe three ladies with us, and they would get to ask questions. And after this part, we'd also open question from the floor. So you could ask question in either English, Cantonese, or Mandarin, or do you know any other language? If not, then...
And the prize will be, if you ask the best question, you'll get a personal photo with Khalil after the...
And the professor will sing.
No, I'm too old.
So, okay, we still have some time. So, you know, the best question ask could get a photo chance with both Professor Song and Khalil, okay? Okay, so we would have, we would open the floor for the lucky draw winners first.
So, greetings to you all again. Thank you very much for sharing, and I'm really impressed. And thank Khalil for bringing a new religion to us. And I have a question for you that is about quite a controversial issue in Hong Kong, that is homosexuality. So from your perspective, what do you think, how your religion can help, like, bring you insight on this issue? And also, we see that some people around the world, they're trying to interpret the God's sayings on their own. But then the truth is, we can never know the true answer because God is not, like, no one can really represent God to give us a discrete answer. So what do you think is the role of religion on the values building, like on homosexuality? Yeah, that is my question. Thank you.
Well, I would say from Baha'i faith, or within the Baha'i faith, the only marriage that exists is between man and woman. However, we believe that the soul itself has no gender. So when, let's say, in the spiritual realm, our souls, when we leave this life, there is no gender to that. But we don't impose our beliefs on others who have their own, of course, right to choose their way of life. I have a few friends who are homosexuals. I have one who I know a bit better, and he, you know, I respect his choice, his beliefs, and he respects my choice of beliefs. So this is the Baha'i faith's understanding on this aspect.
For me, the Bible, again, only accept marriage between men and women. But again, we would not reject any person because they have a different sexual inclination. I think we should respect that people are different. In fact, from the scientific point of view, I think there is a lot of genetic elements in our sexual inclination, and quite a substantial proportion of mankind are actually prefer to have sex with the same gender. Therefore, I would not say that this is something that we should, well, definitely we should not discriminate against them, and we should not treat them like a strange person. We should love them like our brothers and sisters as much as the other people. But I would still say that really from my reading of the Bible, the only accepted kind of marriage is between people from different gender.
Okay, so we have our next question.
Hi, I'm Karen, and actually I'm from Hong Kong Baptist University, and I think the question is that to follow up Professor Song's questions, I want to know if during the SARS period, there is a very, like, when you see there, the hope is really is, I mean, is like a very difficult time and you do not know what's going on and how do you just keep your hope alive? And for Khalil, do you, when there is deficit in your creativity, do you, how do you try to move on?
Okay, as I mentioned, when we run out of our own method, when we have run out of our own wisdom, it is the time when God's intervention becomes so real. And we feel that life and death is not simply decided by how much we know and how much we can do, but there's somebody from above looking upon us, and things are not happening just by accident or randomly. So my position at that time was that I'm only a small part in the history, and what I can do is I contribute the most that I have, and I will pray that we will be in the hands of God, and I trust that He will lead us through the most difficult time. And I think that is what we call faith, and faith is something that you do not have a good reason behind to support it, but you just trust that the good one will be looking after mankind. But to me, that was the time that faith actually exercised its most influence, and it was very real for us, because without faith at that time, I thought many people will just quit or will give up or will feel totally despaired. So I would say, just as I said at the beginning, faith is a journey, and that was a very important turning point of my journey, because again, I quote it from the Bible, there is a person called Job. I don't know whether you have heard this book called the Book of Job. He started as, from the beginning of the book, he was a very wealthy person. He has many animals, he has a lot of children, he was a good man, and then suddenly, a lot of disasters came down upon him. That's because Satan was trying to do some tricks on him. So he lost, suddenly he lost all his wealth, and then he lost his children, he lost his house, and worst of all, he then started to develop an illness, and in medicine we call it Job's disease. And what happened was that he got these boils all over his body. He developed an infection, 很多疮, developed all over his body. And then people treat him by cutting the boil and let the pus come out, a very surgical treatment. And then while he was suffering all this, he asked himself, why all this happened to me? What have I done? I mean, as an ordinary person, you will ask this question, what have I done to deserve this? And then his friend comes around and say, oh, you are a good man, but you probably have done something wrong, something trivial that you don't remember. And then his wife said, yes, you have scolded me last time, and so you're a bad guy, that's why God punished you. And then all this rationalization, all this reasoning, in fact, only add more pain to him instead of answering the question why. But at the end of the book, he suddenly realized that, because he keep asking, why this happened to me. And then God did not explain to him why it happened. What he showed him was the thunder, the storm, the stars, and the moon, and all the features of the universe. And then God asked him, who are you asking me this question? And you know how he responded? The conclusion of the book says, Job then said to God, in the past, I heard about you. Now I see you, and I regret in the ashes, and I know that I'm just a small person. So it's a very, very interesting book for me, especially after SARS. I keep asking, what have we done to deserve this? Why this disaster came to Hong Kong? Why my colleague fell ill? Why some even died? What have we done wrong? Why don't you punish the evil person? There are so many more bad person than we are, and you should punish them instead of us. Why this happened to us? But then the answer is, well, in fact, there was no logical answer. And what God portrays for me is that, well, you are, who are you? You are just a tiny little bit, a grain of sand on the beach. Who are you to ask me this question? You may not be able to understand or comprehend why things happen. And does that mean that this should not happen? I mean, your wisdom is far from my wisdom. So who are you to ask me this question? So what I'm saying is that I still don't understand pain. I still don't understand suffering. But I would hope that my faith can carry me through the next time when it comes. And I hope it will also help you when your suffering comes. Thank you.
Well, I guess I will always go back to this passage that goes, be generous in prosperity and thankful in adversity. So this is something that I would always take to mind. I don't find, even when I do other interviews, some people would say, you know, oh, things must be difficult sometimes or whatever. But I have never really quite found difficulties to be very troublesome. Or maybe I haven't yet had, you know, very troublesome difficulties. But I've always tried to see things in the sense that it's a learning process. So through these hardships, through things that aren't so easy, aren't so smooth, we grow and we become better than we were before. It's a never-ending process. It's like a sword. A sword that is dull needs constant maul. You know, 磨了要磨，那才能去。 till it reaches its full potential to be a very sharp sword, a sword that is functional. So I would see that as an analogy to a person, to a spirit, to a soul, is that it needs this kind of change in order to find, let's say, perfection or be on a path to perfection.
You see, I still want to supplement on this because I think sometimes suffering doesn't really make sense. Recently, I have a friend who is due to retire. His son, who is a CU graduate 2 years ago, and he told me that his son suddenly was diagnosed to have cancer of the lung and spreading to the bone, that is stage 4, that is the final stage. And this is his only son, all right? He never smoked, so why should he develop lung cancer in such a young, talented person? And what kind of sword is that? I mean, how would this suffering improve him or make him a better person? I don't really understand. And he obviously is totally devastated with the news, and he quit his job to look after his son for the remaining months and so on. So I think it is really hard if you want to ask why for each and everything. We do not have an answer. I'll be honest with you. I do not have an answer. I can only say that we are a grain of sand on the beach. and we are only a passenger in the very long tunnel of human history. So we definitely would not be able to comprehend, to understand everything that happens in the history. I mean, in World War II, millions of Jews were killed, all right, in Holocaust. And what sense does it make? I mean, this is to this broken family, to those who lost their loved one. This is totally senseless. And you tell me that we have a God that looks after you, that loves all the Jewish people? Are you kidding me? I mean, it's very hard. Whatever you say, you will be rejected by your logics, by your rationing, isn't it? But, this is life. And this is time when faith is called for to lift, to take you, to bring you through the most difficult moment.
Okay, I believe we have the last question from the winner, and then.
Hello, Mr. Fong and Professor Song. I'm Angela, and thank you for such a fabulous sharing. And so, you know, nowadays a lot of teenagers have their own dream. They don't just want their life to work for earning money. They want to try a lot of things. However, when they are finding and following their dream, a lot of people make negative comments on them. For example, saying that people cannot live without money. So do you two have any ideas on how these teenagers can make a good balance between the reality and the dreams? How can they manage to follow their parents' words and their dream? And do you have any comments or supportive words to those teenagers? Thank you.
Okay, why don't you speak as a teenager and I speak as a parent? I'll speak as a parent.
Okay. Of course, we've all heard that, you know, money, you know, is nothing. You know, that's what, you know, we hear people say, oh, we all, you know, pension, and a lot of people say, yeah, right, you know, money can buy me everything. But, and I would say, I think true happiness really is not from money, though. Like, for me, being an artist, I make more than most people now. But I wasn't any less happier when I was less, you know, wealthy. When I first came to Hong Kong, I would not like to boast and say I was a poor person, no. But we were not, we didn't really have, you know, the ability to rent our own place. So we rented, we knew someone who knew an old retired man who had an apartment, and he had a small room. And this small room was you know, because his wife had passed away, so this room was available. So we had decided to live there for a while. So me and both my parents, we lived in that small room with that old man. He's a very nice man. And, you know, I mean, some would say, you know, in America, you're living in your own house. Some would say that that's, oh, I couldn't take that. That's horrible. I wouldn't even say it's, I wouldn't complain about it. But I would just like to say that I think that in any condition, whether you're rich or poor, I think it's really about how you see yourself in the world. What are the things of true value? Is it that you are able to use whatever you have to help those around you positively, to build a better environment for your family or for those around you? I think service-oriented projects, or even, let's say with my mother, I've worked with her on her educational project for some time now, for about 15 to 20 years. About, let's say 15, I think. And for her, education is both business as it is a service, because she believes that through work, we can influence like kindergarten children. So in kindergarten, we not only teach children English, but rather through these English classes, we teach them morals and values. So we would teach them about kindness. We would teach them virtues. We would teach them the idea of consultation at a very young age. Now, these are like four-year-olds, five-year-olds. We teach them consultation. Consultation in the sense that we should not get into arguments and disputes, but rather everyone should bring forth their ideas and to find a unified understanding with each other. So for me, I think it's really about finding some sort of faith, finding some sort of positive engine to help you along.
And I hope that sort of answers. But it's a very vast question, so I hope that slightly helps.
I would start from, first of all, human physiology. All right? You know, dream is very important in your sleep. If you don't dream, no, honestly, do you know that we have certain type of sleep? If you sleep well and have a dream, we call it rapid eye movement sleep, REM sleep, right? If you don't have dream, you actually do not have a good sleep. Next morning, you wake up still very tired. Oh, that, now you know why you are so tired, right? So, dream is very important for our sleep. And dream is, if you don't have a good dream, you do not have a good life. All right? So please, have a dream. All right? But please do not daydream. Because you need a dream, and then you have a target, you have a goal, you have something to strive for, you have something that you dedicate your life to. And talk to your parents. I need to pursue my dream. Please stop bothering me. Please don't tell me what I should do. If you really have a dream and you have a goal, I would encourage you to do that. But don't just have daydream. Because if you just have a dream but you stop doing anything, you just hope that you become a millionaire or billionaire, but you don't work hard, you don't do something to achieve your dream, then you are daydreaming. Then you better not to have a dream. Then you might just as well find a stable job and then earn a few thousand dollars and call it a day. I mean, so as a parent, and I'm talking to parents in this room, please give them breathing room. Please give them space to develop, to pursue their dreams, and not to impose your dream to your children. My father, fortunately, his dream was to be a doctor. Fortunately, that is my dream as well. But he always say, I want you to be an eye doctor. I want you to be an ophthalmologist, eye doctor. Because, you know, my father is actually an optometrist. His business was to sell glasses to people. He said, I want you to be an ophthalmologist because then you can identify all my clients and send them to me. So I said, Dad, the eye is so small. I mean, it's so insignificant, so small. I want a bigger organ to deal with. So end up, I've chosen the heaviest organ in our body, which is the liver, the longest, which is the intestine. So I still pursued my dream as a doctor, but I chose a specialty, a area of interest, of my interest, not my father's interest. But as I said, do have a dream, but not just daydreaming, not just sit there and don't do anything. Dream big. All right, dream something really significant with long impact, with big impact that helped other people and helped the mankind. All right, don't just dream about little things like buying a house, an apartment which cost a few million dollars. If that is your dream, come on, forget it. All right, so dream big and follow your dream, but don't daydream. Thank you very much.
All right, originally we want to open the floor, but unfortunately both of our speakers have to be excused by 3 p.m., so we have no choice but to invite them to give the final concluding remarks for the section.
Final remarks? Okay, well, I would say actually just what Dr. Professor just said reminded me of something is that my parents, actually, I think it was great that there are two things I learned from them, and I think it's in the Baha'i Faith too, but that we should be, we should take pride in our work. Take pride not to be proud, but rather be humble, I think, and try to make sure that you do the best in life and try to be responsible in every area. And I think that Tim, when he said something earlier the other day, is to find purpose. Everyone has a purpose and a role in the world. And if everyone found this purpose, you know, that would be quite a feat. And as a closing, I really don't have very much to say. I just want to say that I'm very happy to be here to share with you and to meet all of you and you know, all these different faces and from different backgrounds, and to be here with the professor and all of the professor.
Sing a song for us as a conclusion. Is that okay? I think that's what they are waiting for the whole hour, you see. They're certainly not waiting for me to make a concluding remark, but if you sing just two phrases.
Okay. This is a song I've recently been listening to. I think it's very great because I just want to say thank you. So it's 谢谢你给我的爱 今生今世我不忘怀 谢谢你给我的温柔 让我度过那个年代 就是
Professor, would you do the same?
As I said, I'm never a singer, and worse still, I'm sitting in front of a real singer. So no. But I would like to say that please, everybody, if you forget everything we said today, what I suggest is that you keep your mind open, your eyes open, and try to see more, learn more, and understand more before you say, I don't like this. I will reject this. This is not my kind. My destiny is this. But please dream big, look farther, and try to walk an extra mile. I mean, you will not regret to do that. If you already close all your doors right now, shut your ears, shut your eyes, and you will regret. If you daydream, you will regret. So that is my final words, and I hope that you remember Khalil's beautiful song and my humble words. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much for coming today. So we have a small souvenir to give to Khalil. So may Professor Sung present it to Khalil on behalf of the university.
I have to explain to him, this is the motto of our university, Bo Wen Yue Li, all right, done by a great master of Chinese literature, Yao Zhongyi Xianzhen, all right? And this is a stupid word done by me. 全程开唱，这是我们50周年的一个愿望。好，谢谢你。